Today's scripture comes from John chapter 25, verses 25 through 35, and Matthew 2, chapter 2, verse 2. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, but not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. For on him God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to be doing the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "Then what sign do you do, that we may see and believe you? What work do you perform?" "Our fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Jesus then said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst." Where is the one who is sent, who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose, and we have come to worship him. Matthew chapter 2, verse 2. May God bless the reading of his word.
Let us pray. Almighty God, our Father, your generous goodness comes to us new every day. By the work of your Spirit, we ask that you lead us to acknowledge that goodness. We ask that you help us to give thanks for your benefits and to serve you in willing obedience this day of hope through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. I forgot to mention during prayer time, I ask that you please keep a young man we helped about a month ago, Jeff Messer, in your prayers. Jeff has been doing so great, working full time and doing what he's supposed to do, but Jeff was having a hard time affording his insulin, and he was trying to save his insulin up and ended up in the hospital for 3 days. So please keep Jeff Messer in your prayers. And if anybody knows of any places where that people can be helped in getting their diabetes medicine, please let me know and I'll pass that on to him. Well, for many of us this morning, this post-Thanksgiving, you a little full, hopefully? You have enough turkey or ham and stuffing and mashed potatoes? Now, as you celebrated this past Thanksgiving and past Thanksgivings in your mind, were there certain smells about the house that you remember? Smells of the turkey and the stuffing and the pies in the oven. Likewise, as we come and I preach out this wonder of Christmas, when we think about Christmases past as we grew up, what memories do you remember as a child and as you grew up that stick with you this day of hope? Surprisingly, for me as a person who loves to eat, the memories for me involve holiday smells. I look forward to the smells of baking. When I was a child, my grandmother Lavelle would come over every Thanksgiving and Christmas and stay a couple days with us. And like many of you, my grandmother would never cook from a box mix ever. Everything that my grandma did was from scratch. So the moment she came in the door, she was cooking or baking something. So these vivid memories of Christmas and Thanksgiving past of my grandma revolve around the wonderful things that she cooked and the smells that filled our house, our large family, our blessed family. You know, Grandma's been gone since 1975. would take the leftover dough and sprinkle it with salt and sugar and put it in the oven for us kids. That was the way we could help Grandma, right? Wink, wink. She was her trying to get us busy. But the smell of that cinnamon and that sugar on that pie crust is forever in my memories. My friends, the whole scope of this morning's text is about what truly fills us, as you can see from the screen there. What fills us short-term versus long-term? Now, as we just celebrated Thanksgiving, you might have had the world's best turkey until next year's turkey that you remember. As we approach Christmas, this first Sunday of Advent, as we think about the wonder of Christmas, what is in our long-term memories about Christmas wonder? As we approach Advent, as we grow closer to the cross, as we see the star, what leads us short-term and what leads us long-term, eternal? Here we see in this text this morning that Jesus has just fed 5,000 people with only a few loaves of bread and a couple fish. The people have followed him, and they are continuing to request food, just as the previous day they wanted more bread. Likewise, 2,000 years ago, a star appeared, and many followed it to the Bethlehem stable to see the Messiah. Just like our senses of smell lead us to good food, our spiritual senses found in the Bethlehem star lead us to the stable. For many of us in ministry, for many of us as Christ followers, we are endlessly followed by those in need of food and whatever we as God's people can provide. Yet hunger still exists, and we as God's people are called to help in the feeding of the hungry, to clothe the naked, to tend to the sick. But as Christ followers, there is much more that we can provide. Just as many still want more bread and more bread, I also state that we are also in need of more Bethlehem star, more of the star that leads us to the spiritual food of Jesus Christ that continues to still satisfy, not short-term, but long-term. We gather in worship every Sunday because we are hungry for spiritual food as to fill our souls to continue in this world until we meet Jesus, or Jesus comes back, whichever happens. I recall a book titled Breadtime Stories by baker and author Chet Eyre. Chet was a pizza baker, and listen to this. It says in this book that his family grew tired of pizza. Is that possible? But it says that they did. So Chet began to bake bread. It says that he made so many varieties that he needed taste testers at work. Where do I apply? To date, Chet has given away over 10,000 loaves of bread. Can you imagine the memories that Chet has of people that are eating and enjoying his bread? And can you imagine those who have been filled with the bread of Chet? God's people can even do more than Chet by building memories, by sharing God's bread of heaven through Jesus Christ. To quote Chet, you'll find that the true reward of sharing your talents and gifts is knowing that you can make a difference in your own life and the lives of others. My gift is just a loaf of bread. I encourage you to find your talent and your gift and share it with others as much as you can. what are your talents for feeding the physical and spiritual and emotional needs of those around you? What can you do? What can I do? What can we do? Even if some of us can't bake. Can you write cards of encouragement to those that find themselves emotionally starving? Can you share a handshake? Can you share a hug? How can you share the wonder of Christmas this year? The first thing to share this Advent is to share the star. The star that led and leads all of us to Christ. It shines ever so brightly in each and every one of us. The goal of sharing bread is to share it for others to eat. And the goal of sharing the Christmas star is that it gives others the presence and the ability to follow it. We gather this morning, this first Advent Sunday, and we look back on memories while looking forward to making new memories. We gather this morning with open hearts, wanting to hear God's word that reaches beyond material blessings. Beloved, physical hunger is serious need, but society's spiritual hunger is just as serious. The true bread of Jesus Christ offers us this morning the true bread that truly satisfies long-term, not short-term. Likewise, the star still is offered and still calls us all to the Messiah. Yes, it is the star of hope, hope in God's promise, brought forward in human form as a baby born in simplicity and given the name Jesus. Now, when we think of this star and where our Messiah was born, where was Christ born? Was Christ born in a castle? Was he born in fabulous silk robes and garments? No, he came to us in a stable, wrapped in simple cloth. Why did God do this? To show us that this Messiah did not come just for the rich people. He came for all, for everyone. He came in commonality for all. As we look the world events in front of us, our call is stronger than ever to go out in the name of Jesus Christ and to feed those who are hungry spiritually, those who are still yearning for the good news of Christ Jesus. The call of Christ this morning for those of the 5,000 that continue to follow him and we as well that gather this Advent Sunday is to trust God's providence. No matter our earthly wealth or well-being. The message is clear, not only this holiday season, but every day. Our call is not only this holiday season, but every day. The world that God created, the people that God created, must place their utter trust in God and rely on God to supply what is needed. For us, of his creation, we are called to live lives worthy of the ones who place their trust in God completely. Jesus wants us to know that when we trust him completely and when we rely on him and his love and his strength and his grace, that he will supply good gifts. We are a blessed people. Are we not blessed as a congregation? Be around people that we love, to be able to share that good news out into the public, to love others as Christ loves us. You see, each time that we gather in love, the star over Bethlehem shines brighter and brighter and brighter. You see, what was the star of Bethlehem all was to bring people out from the darkness to see the light of Jesus Christ. Now, there are two things that we must do when we see this star. God sent the star to get their attention, and God sends the star still to get our attention. What's the second part of getting that attention? We must decide to follow that star. We must make that free will choice, just like the shepherd did, just like the wise men did, just like all of those that followed the star to the manger that Christmas night. We think about the Exodus, when people followed Moses. You remember when the people screamed at Moses for food because they were starving? It was God that provided, not Moses. The bread was called manna. Likewise, when we scream for spiritual food, Jesus is there for his people as God's bread from heaven, for those who are struggling in the ways of the world rather than in the ways of heaven. Yes, 400 years after the last prophet had spoken, God revealed a star to feed us, just as he fed those in Exodus. Just as they followed Moses, the star still calls us to follow God. As we stuffed ourselves on Thanksgiving and we'll stuff ourselves this Christmas with wonderful food, may we understand that even when our bellies are full, sometimes our souls feels that they're starving. I bring you the good news. I bring you the hope this morning that we can receive the food that is called Christ. He is the bread of heaven, come from heaven to fill our genuine needs of his Father's world. Jesus is the judge who gives life-giving food, manna from heaven, not Moses, but bread from the realm of God. I conclude this morning's message with a story from Devin Huss. In the best-selling book called In the Thin Air, John Krakauer relates the hazards that plagued one group of climbers as they attempted to reach the summit of Mount Everest. Andy Herod, one of the expedition leaders, stayed at the peak too long, and on his descent, he became in dire need of oxygen. Harris radioed the base camp and told them about his predicament. He mentioned that he had come across a cache of oxygen cylinders left by other climbers, but they were empty. The climbers who already passed the canisters on their own ascent knew they were not empty, but rather they were full. They pleaded with him on the radio to make use of them, but it was to no avail. Harris was starved for oxygen, but he continued to argue that the canisters were empty. The problem was that the lack of what he needed in oxygen had so disoriented his mind that even though he was surrounded directly in front of him with the oxygen that he needed to live, he thought they were empty and did not follow to the oxygen cylinders. The lack of oxygen had ravaged his capacity to recognize what was right in front of him. Well, what does this story mean for us today? What is the oxygen to our bodies? We still need oxygen, right? We still need to breathe. Well, the bread of life is what is the oxygen for our souls. Likewise, some cannot see the star as to lead them to hope and to safety. Some of us are suffering and starving, and we don't even know it. Jesus is offering life to us while we run around trying to appease our earthly appetites. We will never be filled until we take the bread and water of life, Jesus Christ. And it all begins this Advent by seeing the star and making the decision to follow it. Yes, holidays are certain events that bring all kinds of memories, just like the smells of my grandmother baking when I was a child, or the mountain climber next to life-saving oxygen that was right in front of him that he failed to grab. Likewise, every day, is a new day. To make a new memory. The memory, remember when you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. Jesus is right in front of us this very moment. Make an eternal, lasting memory and let Jesus fill you with what you need to live. Share the bread of life and share the star that leads us to God's master plan. Let the bread feed you and let the star take you from the darkness of the world to the light of Jesus Christ. And that's our call as we share today's hope so that others can be fed to follow that star that shines brighter and brighter and brighter and will always lead us to the Messiah. This is God's word.